this is the RPG Chick, and welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. And my voice is much better now, yay! So, this kid is from another time. You can watch the last episode for all the details on that. I see your claws again. Alright, let's see what these... This thing is a townsperson. Isn't that the most fascinating execution you've ever seen? Okay, let's see what these merchants are selling. You! I bet you're sick to death of digestible food, am I right? We can't go over to him. I've got some beautiful memory fragments in stock. Lovely gifts for children.
Go.
So, how do we actually... Razor, sharp, regret, or dull remorse? Take your pick. Do I go? That's our stuff. This was all our stuff. So I can't actually interact with these merchants? This guy we can. This portly man's cracked and bleeding hands are always moving, picking fretfully at his thick lips, running through his thinning hair, or molding aimless shapes in the air. His clothes are marked with paint, dust, dried blood, and clay. His eyes brim with frustrated tears as he studies the strangely familiar sculptures arrayed about him. A soul like slivers of ice, he mutters, fingertips long, shriveled, sharp, screams trapped in flesh. She holds him in place. She's killing him. He's not looking at her. Why isn't he afraid? No. He claws absently at his sparse beard. What am I not seeing? What am I missing? And he thinks, who was he? What was he feeling? Without that, I can do nothing. What's wrong? Everything, he says without a moment's pause, effortlessly drawing you into his self-directed tirade. Every detail is almost right, which means everything is wrong. I am Zaofi. That's a funny name. Stone carver, sculptor, divine painter of living eyes, and in this challenge, my greatest work. My talent has finally abandoned me. He sweeps a scornful hand at the sculptures. Behold my art, wanderer. Witness these dull stumps, these crude replicas of a sublime being. What is it you think I've made? Okay, so you use anamnesis to try to recall why the sculptures look so familiar. Success! You stare at the sculptures. Your memories flow into its sweeping curves, teasing you with what you've seen in your short life and beyond. Yes, this towering thing is the true form of the creature that pursues you. Zaofi has sculpted the sorrow. You don't realize that you've spoken aloud until you hear Zaofi's gasp and see the tears in his eyes. Yes, sorrow, or even grief, is present in the work. I feel it, but where? I cannot pull it from the stone. I saw this creature on a cold night not long ago. Smoking coronas of blackened light drew me to my window. He shapes the scene with his palms, and there, on the street below, was she, gripping a man in her talons. Before my very eyes, she ripped his essence from him, leaving him a steaming husk. He drops his hands. But what do you care? You don't grasp the importance of capturing such a subject. So he sees the sorrow as female. I've seen aspects of her. Maybe I can help you capture the details. You think I'm trying to sculpt the killer, he says, and then immediately corrects himself. Of course I am. I've succeeded, in fact. She is beauty and vengeance incarnate. What artist worth his metal couldn't capture such a being? He clucks his tongue. But she doesn't need to be remembered. How could anyone forget such a lethal creature? Silver Tide went up. No, the source of my ruin is this damnable man. He points a trembling finger at the faceless human cradled in the statue's talons, a charred, oddly familiar pattern etched on a stone head. He stared eternity in the face and did not blink. But he will be forgotten unless I capture him here, and I cannot do that unless I know what drove him. He swallows. The moment he fell, I ran for the street, but the Dendra O'Hur claimed his body and took it away, probably to their foul chapel and underbelly. Now I'll never know who he was. How many statues of this being have you made? Ha! If only my efforts could be limited so. I've sculpted that blasted moment in marble, granite, and clay. I've painted it in oil and blood. It even follows me into sleep, where I weave the scene from clouds and dream stuff. A frustrated tear rolls down his cheek. Even those were flawed. Artists, Tabir murmurs. You think they'd be a happy bunch. They slap paint on a canvas, and someone pays them for it. But no, they thrash about in their sleep, moaning and stealing all the sheets. You turn your attention back to Zaofi. Tell me about the Dendra O'Hur. They're a cult and a curse, he says. They would have you believe they exist to preserve the great works of humanity, to celebrate life. You may even believe them until you smell their breath. The truth is that they squat in their underbelly chapel eating corpses and claiming it gives them power. Is there anything else you can remember about the creature that killed your subject? What a surprise, Zaofi says with a ragged, scornful sigh. Yes, let us ignore the incandescent flare of this stranger's brief life and focus on his murderer. She's so much more glamorous. He grips his sparse hair as if it's going to fall out and stares at you. That's what you want, isn't it? That's what everyone wants. He thinks, like so many, she wants flash and flourish, but humanity is what truly inspires. The creature is hurting me too, or hunting me too, actually. I need to learn everything I can about it. Read a book, then. Pester a Skylark with your questions, for all the good it will do you. And when the beast claims you as well, spare a prayer for the artist who will drive himself into a grave trying to capture your final moments. Okay, so blue and silver ties just raise a tiny amount. And draw her. A pack of damnable corpse gobblers with pretensions of mysticism. You can find them in their chapel in the underbelly. If I learn anything about your subject, I'll let you know. He grunts. In several of the pieces, the creature depicted appears almost to lunge out of the stone, almost as if hurtling itself at the sculpture. Perhaps that's why they were left unfinished. There's a slaver over there. Myriad statues sit at various stages of completion, each figuring a figure that leaves you with a feeling... featuring a figure that leaves you with a feeling of profound disquiet when you look at it. Hold on a second, guys. Okay. Canopied wagon beds lie forlornly against the wall. Bereft of axles or any other means of locomotion, they don't appear to be going anywhere soon. Sorry, guys. I'm messing up my readings. Execution route. Okay, so these aren't actual merchants. That is. But these guys aren't. Alright. Fool me. Although I do want to talk to this slaver. Something huge just flew over there. Don't talk to me. Talk to the boss. Oh. Are these the boss over here? Yeah, let's go talk to them then. Did I miss anything? Dried virulent meat, fresh from quarantined smokehouses in the bloom.
As you wish.
It's just what I want. Virulent meat. He whistles. Let's just see what they do. Of course, only he's going to talk to me. We stash slaves here. We don't sell them. The ones down below are bound for the bloom. Toll McGurr. As you approach, the wild-haired woman eyes you speculatively, and whispers something to her companions. They burst out laughing, and a slight smirk plays about her lips. Hey, don't you be making fun of me? A breathing mask dangles from a cord around her neck, and you can see where it has cut permanent grooves into her face. She ruffles her hair, messing it still further, and sings out, "Come to buy a slave, Castoff? If you've come to me, you must want something of the sort." She thinks, she's a fresh one. I can smell it on her. You know I'm a Castoff. The tattoo. I've had dealings with your kind before. I know about you. She rakes her fingers through her hair. If anything, the motion serves to obscure her vision even more. So, Castoff, I have information you might want. Of course, it comes with a price. What kind of information? You think you'll get it from me that easily? I don't think so. I know your type. You Castoffs. Not a one of you can be trusted. I give you this information. You're gone before I can collect my price. So you'll forgive me if I decline to say outright what secrets I hold.
I'll remember that.
Huh. One of my wards has run off. She's taken a head wound. Not my doing. And I've been watching over after her. I don't know where she's gone, but I suspect she's headed to Cliff's Edge. Plenty of other urchins clamoring about the place, and she'd find it easy to blend in. Sadly, my troop and I are detained here, so we can't go ourselves. She thinks, though these lack nibbers are tired of hunting her. Damn girl hides well. Too well. She's a scrawny child, name of Rin. Head wound, but it's covered by dark, curly hair. Has a little necklace around her throat. Babbles about her gods. Go get her for me, and I'll tell you what you want to know. Answer a few questions for me first. Fine. Can you tell me about yourself? I'm a slaver. I'm the last person you want to make an enemy. I've got a reputation for coming through on my word. Nothing else need concern you. What can you tell me about the Order of Truth? You want to deal with them? Be my guest. Those pompous Aeon priests are up by Government Square. Think they can unlock the secrets of the past, but they're not focusing on what's most important, which is creating for the future. They say they're studying, learning, but the fact is they're not doing anything useful. Don't let them tell you otherwise. I have some questions about the cult of the changing god. Her lip curls. Delusional meaning seekers. They spend their time chasing their imaginary deity, ignoring what it means to be alive. Ooh, what has he done now, they say. Can I tongue his divine arse? As if knowing his life makes theirs any better. By studying his actions, they might be able to replicate his successes. Blue tide. I gotta check my tides. Please. If they were going to succeed at anything, they'd have done it by now. But look around. You hear of any of them doing anything of note? Living in grand mansions? Owning fleets of airships? You don't. That's because they're intent on living in someone's shadow. She curls her tongue and spits. Nothing grows in the shade. Keller says, that's factually inaccurate. Several species of arthropods make their homes under the earth. The creatures that live in the forgotten tunnels of the ancients have not seen light for millions of years, yet they thrive. She breaks off, smiling slightly. I can't abide ignorance. Tol McGurr glares daggers at Calistas. Nor metaphor, it seems. Get your little nose out of my conversation. I have some questions about slavery in Sagus Cliffs. It's not so bad. Not horrific. Almost no one sells them for parts anymore. Fact is, most of them go down to the Bloom, where they can work off their debt to society by opening a maw or two. It's not a forever thing. It's a punishment. I have some questions about Sega's cliffs. As someone who cares, I think the city is a sewer. Okay. For some reason, I want to ask her this again. No. Okay, farewell. Sure. Alright. This guy say anything different now?
With same. Alacrity.
With alacrity. I like that. Good word.
On my way.
This scrolls too fast sometimes. Alright. I don't know if I've looked. Let me look here first. This stall stands empty. Deep ruts in the layered rugs hint at heavy furniture hastily moved when the last occupant vacated. Various devices clutter the three tables of this stall. Some of them spark and twitch as if objecting to the proximity of their neighbors. Here, let's talk to Prada, who's the actual only merchant here we can actually interact with. Or buy things with, I'm guessing. If we can buy things from her. In the shadows cast by the folds of this merchant's cowl, you glimpse hints of verdant chitin and amber mandibles erupting from pale human flesh. Her voluminous robes cannot hide the fact that her movements are off, as if too many joints inhabit too little space. But her voice is a warm, tumbling flood of spoken thoughts and impulses. A fair afternoon to you. Warm, isn't it? Something begins humming in one of her many pockets, and her brilliant, multifaceted eyes flicker towards an invisible point in the distance. Well, not as warm as it could be, but this is the warmest minute of the week by a considerable margin. She trails off, but the hum continues. Oh, you have one of those tattoos, too. Anyway, can I interest you in some prime artifacts? Dusty relics? Numenera of uncertain origin? She thinks, she looks like that pale woman. No, you're right, Birdie. Not looks. Smells. Who the hell's Birdie? The thing humming in her robe? Cloak? Pocket? I like that one. You said someone else had my tattoo. Who? Oh, right. A pale lady. She wanted me to fix an artifact of hers, but I couldn't make any sense of it. And that is rare, believe me. I felt sorry for her, to tell you the truth. She seemed sad, like she'd lost something and was never going to get it back. And she thinks, and she would say what she'd lost when I asked her. I know I could have helped. She'd either lost something or was just lost. I wish I could have helped her. I do want to say that, but I'm going to like save that for last. That's kind of like rude to say, isn't it? I've never visited this city before. Can you tell me about it? No. And she laughs. It sounds like a cloud of insects taking flight. Okay, my laughter is not going to sound like that. I'll do better than that. Tell me anything about this place that worries you, and I'll make it better. That's a guarantee. She thinks, we do love to help. Don't we, Rounda? Well, she's thinking two different things now. What part of this city should I see first? All of it. Take it from me. Everything is worth seeing, even the boring bits. Take your time, talk to everyone you meet, and keep your eyes open. Are there any dangerous areas I should avoid? Not at all, she says, waving her claws at you. I heard so many rumors about how the underbelly was ruled by vicious thugs, but when I went down there to make a trade, no one so much as glared at me. She hesitates. Of course, they were probably worried I was going to snip their heads off, but the underbelly is fascinating and worth the risk. Most everywhere is. Do you? Tiber says, leaning over to look at her shrouded hands. Snip heads off, I mean. You don't seem the type. I might be, Preda says brightly. I've never had to find out. Tiber leans back out of snipping range with a fixed, polite smile. Okay. The turning into an insect option is gone. I guess Tiber took that angle for us. Unless it's under here. I'm still finding my way. Think I could get a discount on your goods? Well, she says, looking momentarily uncertain. It's like watching a lone cloud passing across a summer sky. You know what? I'll give you a discount on everything I carry from now until the last star in the sky collapses. Or, you know, one of us dies. Can't do a thing about that. She laughs again, clearly unworried by the prospect. How do we really know we're getting a discount, though? Yeah, it's there. I'm looking for someone who can repair a complex machine. Can you help? Ooh, I'd love to. Complex machines are my favorite. But, no, I shouldn't. I'm really behind on work orders this month. This may surprise you, but I'm very, very, very easily distracted. Okay. She shrugs beneath her robes. You're better off with someone else, sorry. Are you sure you can't help me fix something? Quadruple sure, she says cheerfully. I want to use that discount we talked about. Okay, so she's selling stuff. Spray flesh. Elutriated force. Some of this stuff I... In fact, so far all this stuff I have. A contingent subroutine. Which is a cipher. The next time this character is reduced to 50% or less in health, or any stat pool, automatically refill health and all stat pools. Neat. This violet-black mass is formed in a symmetrical pattern of overlapping rectangles. The shape seems to be alive, or at least animated. Touching it sparks an unbidden, somehow clinical rage. The longer you touch it, the more closely it adheres to your skin. For a price of irrational hatred, you procure one thing, a second chance. Huh. How much is that? So 74. And 65. Yeah, can't be buying that. Third man. Refill health, might speed, and intellect for all party members. This small stone statue of a handsome man is cunningly carved. Something resembling music pays from it, filling the minds of the user and its allies with the hope and belief that victory is not only possible, but inevitable, no matter what odds are being faced. Interesting. A cryophorus dart? 20 chemical damage and confers bleeding. 4 physical damage per turn. Active for 3 rounds. This hollow black rod contains a small but impossibly sharp dart. A button on the end of the device releases the projectile, injecting the target with a compound that instantly freezes. Wow. That's gotta be pretty uncomfortable. Reconstitutor. Heals 10 points of health on all allies in range of target point. This small green coil of braided wire unravels when placed on the ground? In the ground? Healing wisps emanate from the strands, knitting together wounds. Phased detonation. Is that what I have? I have unstable detonation. 12 transdimensional damage and confers hobbles to all characters in range of the target point. The edges of this featureless yellow polygon bend at impossible angles, folding in and out of existence. When cracked open, it snaps back fully into this reality, releasing a wave of phased force. As opposed to mine, which is... energy damage, not transdimensional. And we got a Praesector. Confers Praesector's eye on target. You know, it looks like we can mouse over these things, but it doesn't work. 30% evasion. So I guess Praesector's eye just does this. This small handheld device is a cylinder about the size of a pen and made of a smooth, unfamiliar material. It is covered in snake-like coils of thick cable. By pointing the cylinder at a living target and pressing a small button on its base, the user can bathe the target in greenish light. This leaves it disoriented and reduces its muscular flexibility for a time. However, the light also causes disjointed and disturbing images to flash to the mind of the user, possibly distracting her. I really can't get any of this stuff. I mean, technically a few of them I can, but will leave me with almost nothing, so... none of it seems vital at this point anyway. Okay, so my last option. You appear to be transforming into an insect. I know! Isn't it fantastic? Well, she doesn't seem offended. I think it might be caused by the intermingling fields of the Numenera I use to organize my thoughts. Or the ones I'm selling. Maybe all of them? You never know how a variety of ciphers will interact with each other. They are such fun. Intersection of Numenera energy fields. Something in the air. Who knows? Enjoy the market. Huh. Alright, we've come full circle. Did I talk to Otero? Wind spins off the distant sea, sweeping between you and the boy, whistling up toward the peaks of Sega's cliffs. He glances at you, then the crowds in the plaza beyond. He appears to be looking for someone. He thinks, would she have come to the city? Doesn't seem like her kind of play, but... So you're wandering down on the roof. The reef, sorry. He says, did you get to that star before the others did? He looks back at your face and grins. Guess not. That inner face that's found good pick. Thanks. A lot of people went looking for the star, didn't they? Nah, not too many. Gotta be a carker to go down to the reef. That place is haunted. But despite his hard words, his eyes settle on yours, studying, deciding. His mouth settles into an irritated line. Look, he says, running a hand over his stubbled scalp. You hide it well, but I can tell you're new here. I ain't trying to offend you, but I don't like leaving folk new to Sagus on their own. If you have questions about the city, or Circus Minor in particular, I'll answer them free of charge. Of course, it looks like you already have a guide, he says, nodding at Calistage. Calistage? He thinks, why is this freshie traveling with her? She scares the tolk out of me. Hello, dear, your companion says politely before turning to you. Otero knows this city better than almost anyone, and it's quite unlike him to give anything away for free, let alone his terribly valuable advice. Do take him up on his offer. Nice of you to say, Otero says, eyeing you. Well? I'm pausing, guys, to drink hot chocolate, trying to keep my vocal cords nice and warm and stuff. Do you live here? Not really, he says. Walls are nice, but they keep you in one place. I like to move around. Explore. He thinks, don't like being here much at all, really. City folks are scarier than scroungers. You know, I'm waiting for the time... No spoilers, please. I'm waiting for the time where these scanned thoughts will be someone actually thinking things to us because they know that we're scanning their thoughts. I'm looking for the cult of the Changing God.
I'll remember that.
Well, you're not going to be able to miss him, he says, smirking. They're camped around that weird clock on the other side of the square. He settles his hands on his hips. What do you want with those crockers, anyway? They owe you something? I just need to ask them a few questions. Fair enough, he says, shrugging. Even crockers get it right sometimes. You don't have a home? Don't need one, he says. I carry my life with me. He pats his bags. Where's the Order of Truth?
Making a note.
In Government Square. From here, follow the path around to the left and look for the stairs going up. So we're in Circus Minor now? Yeah, the heart of the city, he says, folding his arms. The levies and politicians will tell you that Government Square is the center of Sega's Cliffs, but they're not exactly right. He spreads his hands, framing the plaza. When folk come to Sega's, they come here. They talk and trade, flirt and fight, tell stories. Everyone who comes here leaves different. His hands fall. Anyway, what do you want to know? What's happening on that stage? An execution, he says, rolling his eyes. It'll be going on for a few days yet. All those folks think they'll learn great truths from the nightmares of a dying man. He shakes his head. It's not worth my time, but I think it might be worth yours if you haven't seen one before. Does anyone around here know how to fix complex machinery? He says, scanning the plaza. Prada, that's the bug lady in the market. Is pretty good with machines. You might ask her for advice. Yeah, tried her already. He rubs the back of his neck. Otherwise, you'll want to visit the foreman in the underbelly. They might be able to fix it, if they can stop fighting long enough. The foreman? The foreman down the underbelly. What are you doing here, anyway? Just got back from a scrounge, he says. I'm here trading salvo for supplies before I set out again. Enjoying the sights, you know? His eyes sweep the crowds again, and he thinks, where would she have gone if she came here? And why? You can't help but notice that he doesn't seem to be enjoying himself. He looks downright unhappy. Guilty, even. Yay for perception, Jack. Who are you looking for? He flinches, then glares at you. At first, it seems like he's not going to answer. A girl I met a while back, he says at last, looking away. She was new in town, like you. I'm just wondering what happened to her, if she's okay. He swallows. Anyway, you have any other questions? He thinks, it didn't look like she broke camp, more like she left in a hurry. What can you tell me about this city? Depends on what you want to know, he says. I spend most of my time in Circus Minor, but there's other districts too. Government Square, Cliff's Edge, the Underbelly, and Caravanserai. He scratches his chin. There's also the Reef of the Fallen Worlds, but you've already been down there. Tell me about the Reef of Fallen Worlds. Only carkers, slavers, bullies, and diggers desperate for scrounge go there. And you, of course. He stares past you down the winding steps. Besides, folks think it's haunted by ghosts from the previous worlds, and I've seen enough down there to agree with them. But you don't need me telling you what it's like. You're lucky you didn't get robbed on your way back. Or worse. He eyes you expectantly. I don't know. Should I trust him? I really don't trust anyone in this place. Not yet, anyway. Except maybe that little boy. Why the hell not? Someone named Koro tried to rob us on the way up. I bluffed my way past him. Silvertide. Heh, that's not easy. Otero rubs the back of his neck sheepishly. I got a good kicking for him for trying the same thing once. Yeah, well, I wonder what your minus to deception is. Because I have a minus one. And I was able to do it. I want to know about Caravanserai. That's the port of Sagas, he says. Any ship that can fly lands there, makes their trades, and takes off for foreign lands. He turns a scornful eye toward the distant flags on a high crag. Plenty to see right here in Sagas. Don't know why people insist on leaving. What is Cliff's Edge? A damn dangerous place to live, he says, laughing. Folks build their houses out on the ledge, over the sea, and everyone gets upset when one of them falls. I hear it's been getting worse lately. Watch your feet up there. Can you tell me about the underbelly? Imagine an underground place where the city sends everyone they don't like. Cannibal cultists, mutants, carkers and thugs. Now add a stink like burning metal and cooking meat. That's the underbelly. You mentioned Government Square. I did, he says, nodding. Bet you can guess what's up there. Where can I find a place to sleep around here? The cult of the Changing God might let you sleep in their camp. Or you can try Tranquility's Rest in Caravanserai. Alright, farewell. See you around. Okay. We've come full circle. All we've done is... I haven't even gone here. We went to the execution ground. And we just looked at all this area. That's it. Which is what? 3-4 episodes already? I think 3. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode when we explore some more of this place. And who knows, maybe we'll run into a quest completion or so, or two. Maybe. Thanks for watching. See you next time and endure. In enduring, grow strong.